take some adjournments. When we adjourn, if I could ask that filming stops, that would be very helpful. Thank you. It's sometimes, in my experience, a little bit hard to gauge how to refer to us. Inspector, Mr. X is, not Mr. X, sorry, Mr. Bristow, Mr. Warden, or Sir are all absolutely fine. Now, the latest version of the local plan, we have this examination document SD/1 on the examination website. Now, if ever you hear us speaking in alphanumeric code, it's probably a reference to local plan examination documents, which are all on that website also. Now, with thanks to the council for providing Wi-Fi, I'm on it. I think there are instructions on the wall if anyone needs to access that as well. There are also hard copies of some documents at the back of the room, if anyone needs to refer to those, including all the Regulation 19, i.e. the Local Plan Regulations 2012 representations. And I mentioned the examination website. That is maintained by Kerry Truman, the Programme Officer, who many of you will have contact with already. Kerry, could I just ask you to give a wave, if that's all right? There we are. That's Kerry. Thank you, nicely done. Now, Kerry is independent of the council. She's responsible for the administration of the examination under our direction. She has and will send out correspondence to participants from time to time. And any queries should be directed to her in the first instance for impartiality. And just on that point, please don't approach us outside of hearing sessions, however lonely we might look. And that includes during breaks and adjournments. That's just so everything that we hear and everything that we say is also heard by everyone. We'll try in the course of things to speak plainly, however referencing planning terms, abbreviations, examination documents can be a bit confusing. So please let us know if anything that we say is unclear. Just to be aware, every representative has both a 7-digit numerical ID and is also allocated one of a number of LPSD numbers based on individual points on certain matters. The latter enables comments to be put against, comments to be put against various bits of the local plans and interactive facility on the council's website. It's very useful for tracking those. So the purpose of the hearings? To ensure that we have heard everything that we need to determine whether the plan is legally compliant and sound, or whether it could be made so. It's also to ensure everyone has had the relevant appropriate say in this forum. Everything okay? Yeah, okay, just checking. Hope you don't have to sound like that. Yes. Okay. Running a local plan, given the breadth and depth of local plan examination, given the breadth and depth of views, is complex. There has been some correspondence asking for our views on certain matters related to the substance of the plan before the hearings start. We can't, of course, address that preemptively. We would, though, make clear that we have read all the information and representations before us and will ensure that everything material is dealt with at the appropriate juncture in proceedings. Now, evidently, a huge amount of effort has been undertaken by the council in preparing the plan, and we thank them for that work, and also for everyone who has taken the time and effort to make contributions and their views known. So if we move on to some housekeeping or formalities before we start properly, could I ask that you silence mobile phones or other things that might beep? And could I ask the council to confirm arrangements in the case of a fire alarm, please?
Thank you. I can confirm that no fire tests are planned today. Should be alarm sound. Please could everybody exit via the fire doors and make your way to the
breaks and overnight, is that?
Yes.
Is that great? Thank you. Okay. We are being recorded by the council. There are other individuals making recordings as well, and we're going to be live screened. I've mentioned about using microphones for that purpose. Now, in terms of data protection, you can see the council's data protection policy on their website, and PIN's data policy, for that matter, on the government website. I think we can, but Kerry has arranged nameplates. We can see them all, that's useful. In terms of process, we'll invite certain people to speak or ask questions of them, but not everyone. If you do want to speak on a particular point, the general process is to, if they can, stand up. To tip your nameplates on end to indicate you wish to speak. Now, instead of going around the table initially in the session, what we'll probably do is ask people to say who they are when they speak. The exception, of course, being the council, will always be at the table, and we will ask to introduce themselves in a bit. Practically, in certain sessions, there'll be lots of people around the table. A number of people have grouped together behind the common spokesperson. That's exceptionally useful for us. And we would just say that if any part of an organisation or group of individuals wants to speak other than the spokesperson, that should only be where there is either a divergence of view or to elaborate on points, not to repeat what has already been said. And we can't stress that point enough, really. We've seen all the representations and the position statements, and we'll be asking questions based on that and what we need to know. And as set out in our examination guidance, there's no difference as to how we treat everything, whether it's come in writing or is discussed verbally at the hearings. So, and I suspect I've broken my own rule, please could I ask everyone to keep your contributions brief and to the point. We will probably stop you if it's something we've already heard. It's the substance of points that count, not how many times it has been mentioned. And at this point, personal reflection, I would say that sometimes people find hearings and inquiries disappointing in that their function is for us to hear what we need. It's not to reach a view on things here and now. And any report will inevitably not cover the level of detailed discussion in hearings, particularly as here there are 155 policies in the local plan. Now, a couple more points before I hand over to Mike to talk us through the format of the hearings and some procedure. Hearings can be nervy events. I struggle with anxiety, so if you're nervous, you're in good company, and we'll try and create as collaborative a space for discussion as possible. We're also here examining a plan. It's not the same format as a planning inquiry or appeal hearing. Our approach effectively is not binary, in that we're not necessarily reaching a finding of whether the plan stands or falls. It may be modified, and you may hear us refer to our thinking about potential main modifications, or MMs, in that respect. And if I could just ask everyone with that in mind to approach things openly and constructively about how, if the plan is not sound in your view, it might be made so. So that's my introduction. Mike's going to talk us through a bit more detail about the format of the hearings and the examination process. Mike.
Thank you. The hearing sessions will take form of a structured discussion led by us. These will generally follow the order of the issues and questions which you set out in our matters, issues and questions document, for which you have followed in making your representations. One of us will lead on a particular issue, but in most cases the other inspector will be present and may ask some questions. We generally have more questions than set out in our MOQs, mainly because we will want to probe into the evidence in your representations. There will be follow-up questions. Having switched off mobile phones, I haven't switched off my phone. And I don't know how to switch it. It's not like...
I shouldn't have called you.
Sorry. Everyone's looking, it's not you, it's me. So sorry. Yes, in some sessions we asked the council to lead off and set the scene and then we'll initiate discussion. In other sessions we may go straight into questions to a participant and start the discussion that way. If you don't understand the question or feel the answer not been given, then please tell us. In all cases, we will give last word to the council on a matter as it is council plan. We will not hear repeated evidence and there will be no cross-examination. The inspectors will lead the discussion and questions will come through us. Only those who have made a representation seeking a change to the plan will have a right to be heard and will be allowed to speak. All others must observe only. As Mr. Bristow said, we've read all the written representations and we don't need people to repeat that here. Instead, we intend to move on from that position and through questions and discussion, get an understanding of the concerns, what they are, and the evidence for them, and what changes then need to be made and they do to the plan. The Programme Officer has produced a programme for block one of the hearing sessions. Please keep an eye on the programme. It could change. It is on the website. The Programme Officer will communicate any changes with participants. As a result of the public inquiry into the series of linked appeals made by the Leaving Union State, local planning examination will be split into two blocks. There will be block one now, which will run until mid-May, and then we will commence block two after the closure of the Leaving Union inquiry. We anticipate that block two will be held during September, October, but the actual sitting weeks and programme have not yet been confirmed. For those MIQs who have originally programmed block two, we will also issue our second set of matters issued and questions, and we will also set out a timetable for additional representations to be made relating to them. For those matters which were in block one and which have been moved to block two, we will not be granting additional representations because we already have them. In this section being the council, but as you know from our circulated note last week, some matters originally planned for block one are to move block two. Today, details are on the note on this website, so I'd urge people to look at that note. In respect of the updated additional evidence submitted by the consortium, we will be allowing specific further additional representations from qualified respondents, and we will issue arrangements for this in due course. As a result of the programme changes, we will sit this week and deal with matter one. Once our openings and council openings are complete, we will not sit next week or the week after, the week after lies between the two bank holidays. We will deal with matters five and six in the week commencing Tuesday the 9th of May, and in that week all sessions will be online via Microsoft Teams. Further details about the online arrangements will be released by the programme officer. I just want to turn now to some key points about the examination process. As set out in our guidance, our role is to consider whether the plan complies with the relevant legal requirement and is sound. Soundness is defined as being positively prepared, justified, effective, and consistent with national policy. So it is vital that all participants remain focused on why, in their view, the plan is not sound or legally compliant, and what changes need to be made to the submitted plan to make it so. Our job is not to improve the plan. We may consider that improvements could be made, but as long as that is not a soundness issue, we will not come forward. We are simply focused on soundness and legal compliance. It is therefore very important that you make clear how you consider the plan should be modified to make it sound, or and why it is not, in your view, legally compliant. I will now turn to the issue of admission sites. These are sites that are not part of the submitted plan, but may or may not have been considered as potential sites at early stages. We know in respect of this plan, a number of participants are promoting such sites, and some of you have given details of them in your representations. However, they are not part of the submitted plan and are not before this examination. Therefore, we will not be considering them. However, as some of you have said, if you consider the plan as unsound because, for example, that you argue that the strategy which led to the sites being allocated in the plan is unsound, then that is an argument that we can hear and we can contest it. There are three possible outcomes to the examination. The first is that the plan is sound as it stands. sound, but could be made so by main modifications. This is a more common position with planning examinations. The council have formally requested that we recommend main modifications that were considered to be necessary. The third option is that the plan is not sound and for whatever reasons cannot be made so. We will try to be open with our thinking and flag up any concerns we have at the earliest opportunity. The policies map is not a document, development plan document, and we cannot therefore recommend modifications to it directly. However, the representation of the plan policies on it need to be consistent with the policies themselves. So we will be discussing, when we come round to the sessions, the policies that will then have an impact on the policies map. Throughout the examination, the council should maintain separate lists of potential main modifications and potential additional modifications. We will ask for the latest iterations posted on the examination website from time to time. It would be helpful to us if during discussions in the sessions and in preparing schedule of main modifications that the council could indicate their position on those modifications, whether they agree, whether they object, or whether they agree with the caveats. We have already familiarised ourselves with the plan area and have visited many of the areas and sites and allocations. We will be visiting others during the course of examination. We expect to be able to see what we need to see from public places in most cases. If we consider that we need to go to private land to see a site, we will make arrangements to this group program officer and the council, and we expect any sort of site visits would be unaccompanied. I'll now turn to the council, and I will ask the council to introduce themselves. I'd also like the council to ask if they've got any questions on the opening statements that myself and Mr. Bristow have made, and then the council will make an opening statement.
Thank you very much indeed, sir. Good morning. So, my name is Christopher, that's the easy bit, Katkowski, Katkowski, King's Council. I'm instructed on behalf of the council for this open plan examination. Now, sir, as you can imagine, the team sitting to my right is going to change depending on which issue and or which question we're discussing. Would you like those who happen to be sitting to my right for the first issue, would you like them to introduce themselves now, or should we do that when we come to the issue itself?
I think probably the second. When we come to the issue, we will gradually get to know council team. But I'm grateful to
you for introducing.
you. So I'm Councillor Janette Williamson, leader of Wirral Council. Please bear with me, I've just about got my voice back, so hopefully I'll get through the introduction. It's really lovely to see you. So Mr. Inspectors, on behalf of the Borough's residents and all the elected members, can I begin by welcoming you to the beautiful Wirral Peninsula and Wallasey Town Hall for the start of the examination of the Council's local plan. This is an important milestone for the Borough. The plan sets out an ambitious and achievable transformational agenda for Wirral. Wirral is a special place, a peninsula surrounded on three sides by internationally imported ecology, beautiful natural areas, much of which is designed as green, designated as green belt. We have 26 conservation areas in Wirral, including Port Sunrise and Hamilton Square, which are of national importance. We are proud that Borough Head Park has recently been shortlisted for potential nomination for inscription on the UNESCO World Heritage List. However, the Borough is a place of contrast in terms of economic and social conditions between the more affluent western side and the more deprived eastern side. Parts of the Borough, including Birkenhead, are amongst the most deprived communities in the country, where people on average die 10 years younger than people living in West Kirby or Heswell. At the same time, located within Birkenhead and other parts of the eastern side of the Borough, as a result of our industrial legacy, lies one of the most significant supplies of undeveloped brownfield land in the country. This includes Wirral Waters, which is the largest single brownfield land regeneration project in the country. After years of extensive engagements and consultation, the local plan has at its heart the transformation of the eastern parts of the borough. The plan makes the best use of the extraordinary opportunity presented by the vast amount of brownfield land while protecting the green belt. We see the local plan as doing the right things for the right reasons. We recognise that we cannot deliver the scale of transformation required alone. We've developed a collaboration agreement with our key funding partners, Homes England and the Liverpool City Region Combined Authority, to develop the Left Bank Regeneration Programme. This focuses on the eastern part of the borough from New Ferry through Birkenhead, including the Wirral Waters Dockland area, Seacombe, Liscard and New Brighton. This approach has already seen progress in delivering regeneration across the Left Bank area. With assistance from Homes England, a national pension fund and the council, Peel Land and Property have begun the delivery of market-changing new homes on the north bank of the Brighton Slope Dock, which marked the beginning of the transformation of Birkenhead. Residents have already moved into aspirational dockside homes at Redbridge Quay, which include a range of highly sustainable family homes. Redbridge Quay is a key part of the emerging North Bank neighbourhood of Wirral Waters, sitting between the beautiful Grade 2 listed grain warehouses and the new park, North Bank Green, and is transforming Wirral Docks into a place of green and sustainable urban living. Another of the developments that Miller's Quay will deliver over 500 highly sustainable and energy efficient homes, including 100 affordable homes delivering significant social benefits. The Belong Extra Care project will also begin on the North Bank later this year. This transformation of Wirral Waters follows significant investment in placemaking infrastructure around the Great Floats. This includes Birkenhead Met College building, the new Tower Bridge, including highway and public grounds works, and the Hive Grade A office development, active travel routes. We are excited about the incredible potential of Wirral Waters, which is of national significance in scale by itself. With the Birkenhead 2040 regeneration framework, we believe we have the biggest opportunity in the country to utilise brownfield land to create a new town within an old town, Birkenhead. Over the life of this local plan and beyond, this framework will help create a new vibrant, attractive, green and sustainable low-carbon town. It will match the successful regeneration of Liverpool city centre on the opposite bank of the Mersey, in a complementary but distinctively different flavour, with strong emphasis on providing for family living. Our local plan contains proposals that will involve the biggest changes to Birkenhead since the Second World War. It will reshape the town. town centre with thousands of new homes. Over 30 acres of brownfield land to the immediate south of the town centre at Hind Street, which has lain vacant for many years, some of it since the Second World War. It will deliver 1,400 new homes as part of a high-quality, low-carbon urban garden village. This will be a unique and sustainable development for the region, having two railway stations with access to Liverpool in 5 minutes and Chester in 30 minutes. This is not a dream. The council now owns a substantial part of the site and is working with development partners to submit the planning application soon. The council has used its covenant borrowing strength to support a number of these projects and will continue to do so where appropriate. This includes a key project by the Wirral Growth Company to provide 150,000 square foot of new grade A office space in Birkenhead Town Centre. Recognising the robustness of our regeneration strategy for Birkenhead, in recent years the Council has received over £100 million from the Government and the Combined Authority through future high street funds, town deal, levelling up, brownfield land grant and transport related funding. This is being spent on essential placemaking infrastructure that will improve developer confidence and viability, including the most extensive public rail and active travel infrastructure improvements ever implemented in Birkenhead. One example is Dock Branch Park, which will see the transformation of one of the world's finest railway lines, which serve Birkenhead Docks, into a world-class linear park. Not only will it provide a strategic open space for the thousands of new residents who will live in Birkenhead, but it will provide the catalyst for and backdrop to new mixed-use residential neighbourhoods along its path. Design work for Argyle Street, Hamilton Square, Woodside, Conway Street and Dock Branch Park are all at an advanced stage and delivery works will commence later this year. The local plan informed by the Birkenhead 2040 framework and wider evidence base identifies the need for a number of master plans in Birkenhead and elsewhere along the left bank to guide and promote regeneration. Master plans will foster placemaking and ensure that a comprehensive and coordinated approach is taken to the planning and delivery of development and infrastructure across key sites. The Council understands the need to give certainty to the market and to developers and investors, and work has already advanced on the preparation of 12 master plans and neighbourhood frameworks across the borough. This level of spatial planning reflects a serious commitment by the Council and our partners to deliver regeneration. As part of the Regulation 18 consultation, we received over 26,000 separate responses, the vast majority of which were from our community, objecting to the release of greenbelt land and supporting our preferred option to meet the needs of the borough for the brownfield first regeneration strategy within our existing urban areas. If you want to understand why, then take a look around as you travel from Wallasey Town Hall. The surrounding neighbourhoods of Seacombe, Wallasey and Birkenhead are in desperate need of regeneration, but with incredible waterside settings, they can be used to improve neighbourhoods. Any release of greenbelt would undermine the regeneration of these areas. Mr. Inspectors, in closing, it's important for you to know what the local plan before you has received not only the overwhelming support of our community, but also every single member of the council who voted to support and approve our plan for submission in March 2022. This truly is the council's plan for the people of Wirral. Thank you for bearing with me.
The opening being made available on the website, and when it is, for those who are intrigued by the reference to the Dock Branch Park as being the world's finest railway line, actually it's the
So, Mr. Wells, that's acceptable to you, Mr. Sarsfield.
Thank you very much.
Stoneford Developments. That's acceptable to you. Okay. Thank you very much. So, we'll take a break now, and we will resume at 11:00.